Welcome to Talking Jazz. My guest today is vocalist educator Janiece Jaffe. Janiece is a very dear old in terms of length of time that we've been connected friend of mine, and we've done many things together, but she also did so many other things, and I'm excited to get to share some of her beautiful, beautiful music and vocal style. So welcome, Janiece.
Thank you so much. This is really awesome to be here.
I got the first time I met Janiece was I was accompanying her for a voice lesson. She was vocalizing along Twisted to a classical voice teacher who had no clue what to do with her. And in the corner was her two-year-old toddler crawling around every so often craving for attention. And obviously, it was not an easy path for you to get into this jazz route, but a very important attraction. So tell me a little bit, what drew you into this jazz music and into performing?
First of all, I'm so glad that you were able to come, because I needed that at that time to switch from classical to what I really wanted to do. Unfortunately, she didn't really understand what to do with me. You know, I grew up in Bloomington, Indiana, and this is the heart of jazz education from way back because of David Baker and Dominic Spera and others, but originally because of that. And I went to high school with his daughter. I was enamored by jazz because I went to North High School, which is notorious for their jazz department. She just brought up so many jazz musicians in that high school. And so I had a lot of jazz musician friends. I would go and hear them jam. And then I would always go to the Monday night jazz concerts series at the Musical Arts Center here in Bloomington. I really did grow up around it, even though my father was a classical musician and also really was not attracted to jazz and or didn't really understand it.
You know, it's interesting. What drew me in is just that process of getting together and being able to create in the moment, rather than in classical music where you prepare the masterpiece and your goal is to interpret the master's mind. But jazz is like going on to an adventure. It's like going to game night like every day. And I know you're similar in spirit and you're a very true improviser. So my guess is you couldn't leave your hands off this process either.
I was not an improviser earlier on. I took classic music lessons. I took opera and I was in many, many musical theaters because my dad was involved with that and my mother was an opera singer. I really didn't understand about it until I got really to high school and started learning more about it. And I would sit in and I would sing things like Summertime, but I was not improvising at the time so much besides, you know, improvising the phrasing. It wasn't really until I got invited to come to the IU Jazz School by David, I decided I really wanted to do this. So I started taking voice lessons directly from him. I think after maybe a month or so, he said, well, you know, if you really want to do this, and I already had my four children at the time, he said, you should just come into my program. Then he gave me a scholarship and ended up there. And that's where pretty much we met almost that same year, I think. I was thrown into the ocean of improvisation, had to learn how to swim in that environment.
Kind of hints to this first dragon. We'll talk about that a little more, because the way you expanded the boundaries of improvisation in terms of using the voices is pretty amazing and much far beyond jazz. You know, it's not about jazz. It's just deeper way of engaging. And I love that.
It's sound healing as well. And, you know, my studies with Bobby McFerrin and Rhiannon have deeply embedded lots of different sounds into my sounds, including overtone singing. That was really from sound healing practices, those sort of things. So yeah, over time, you know, I got really focused in on the way it was in school. There was a lot of competitions. It's a very masculine oriented way of being with the music. You know, the dueling saxophones, and learned a lot. I took my undergrad in 6 years because having four children at home, it really did take me that long to move through what I needed to get to learn, you know, in my bones what this music was about.
So standing on the edge, you know how much that actually describes feeling. So our first tune we'll listen to is Standing on the Edge, which is much later than as the time that we are talking about. It came out of collaborating with some of the people that we all met during those years, who became quite a centerpiece of the contemporary jazz scene, you know, something that's cool to see, especially out of a big school like Indiana University, where you have people come together to study, is that you know these people later on will be in many, many different leading positions because they are already the leaders. So this one you did with guitarist Marcos Cavalcante, who came from Brazil at that time, also raising a family and having to overcome that. He was there on a scholarship from Brazil. That is a wonderful collaboration. I would say let's listen to that first. We'll talk a little bit more about those collaborations. This is Standing on the Edge, and it's Marcos Cavalcante on guitar and Janiece Jaffe on vocals, Jamie Reed on the drums, Tom Clark on sax, Mark Buselli on the trumpet, and John Huber on bass. 2005. Enjoy. From the 2005 release, Standing on the Edge, that my guest today, Janiece Jaffe, produced, featured her on vocals with Marcus Cavalcanti on guitar, Jamie Reed on drums, Tom Clark, saxophone, Mark Buselli, trumpet, and John Huber, bass, you know, and me reading off these names brings all kinds of memories because those were the people we took classes together and shared rooms. For example, Mark, now he's the head of jazz studies at Ball State University. He has toured the world, written arrangements for so many, everybody there. And so you were able to take advantage of finding these people.
There's so much richness in the program. Really, your peers are almost the richest thing of all. You just get to collaborate on so many different levels. And I remember Marcos, I might have mentioned to him that I really like to write lyrics. He asked me to put lyrics to his songs. And so what I did was I asked him, why did you write this song? Then how can I bring out the meaning of the song from what he said? But I don't think that he gave a huge background on Standing on the Edge. It's like the flow of the music just brings the words to me. And so that's, you know, I know we've collaborated that way as well. You know, I love putting words to your music. I love putting words to the music that is more angular or more challenging or, I'm just like, yes, let me in there, get in there and do that. Yeah. So I was just so happy to do that. This is actually one of the CDs that I'm just so proud of because of that extra fact.
I want to head to another release, the Heart's Desire release, which you did with Simon Rowe. He also came to Bloomington. He didn't go to school. His wife, you know, Bloomington is an interesting town because most people have some relations to the university. Either they study there or they come here because a spouse is there. And it creates a really cool community of people with different intellectual interests and backgrounds. And Simon Rowe came here for a few years. He's now out in San Francisco. He's Australian. You were able to connect and created an interesting bubble at that time of creating a record label and bringing in, he came from St. Louis, I believe, and right, brought all these artists together. So tell us about that collaboration a little bit that you did with Simon.
I really didn't know about the music business, and it's changed dramatically since then. The way that we did things is not the way we do things now. But the heart of it was Catalyst Productions. It's no longer intact because the gentleman who helped him start it with the finances was just passionate about jazz. Their passion was to bring to light some of the Black artists from the St. Louis area that really deserved to be nationally known because of their talent, but never quite got to that next ring, the next level or whatever, being heard. So that was the heart behind the company. And so he played piano with these people and really brought a lot of richness and learned. I mean, he talks quite often about learning so much from each one of these artists. It was life-changing for him. He started out as a trumpet, really became quite proficient on piano. So that's what that was all about. And we had office hours and just were in the trenches. I helped with the logo and everything it takes to put together a CD, nothing digital yet. You know, there's a lot of work. And then traveling, you know, after the CD is finished and creating places to play like the Shelton in St. Louis and Buskirk Shumley Theater here, that sort of thing. So it was really fun and I learned a lot, but now that information is a little old. You got to keep up with the times.
It was quite impressive what Simon was able to put together with Catalyst Productions. What were some of the artists on there?
Right. Well, Jeannie Trevor was a vocalist from the area. Lukman Hamza was actually from Kansas City. It was actually the first one was a saxophone player who's passed on since then.
It was very impressive what he was able to build and share. And then you were able to put out your own release.
I'm the one that really produced this one because by the time that it got to this time, the Catalyst had stopped just only because the partner had gotten cancer and really needed to refocus his energy. So by that time, I was able to go ahead and do this and invited that trio to be a part of Heart's Desire. This song was for my children in general, but when I was recording it, they were still growing up. You know, I had that, hey, I'm going to have to let go of the child and allow the adult to emerge, you know, in my children, and they're going to let go of their teddy bears and, you know, all of, yeah, this is kind of dedicated to my children.
On the recording, we have Simon Rowe, of course, is on piano, and we have John Huber back on bass, and Pete Wilhoyt is on drums, who also went on to become a member of Fiction Plane, which is the band of Sting's son, and ended up playing with the whole Police reunion tour, which is kind of an interesting legacy. Incredible drummer. He's in New York now. Very versatile in all styles. Let's have a listen. So this is Waltz for Debbie.
Dolls and clowns and a prince and a big purple bear. Lives my favorite girl, unaware of the weary frowns that we worry grown-ups all wear. Dances to silent music, songs and a smile of gold somewhere in her own little head. One day, all too soon, she'll grow up and she'll leave her dolls and her prince and her silly old bear. When she goes, they will cry. She whispers goodbye. You know they'll miss her, but then so will I. Leave her dolls and her prince and her silly old bear. down she goes, they will crash. She whispers goodbye. They'll miss her, I feel, but then so rude. They'll miss her. They will miss her, I feel, but then so rude.
Bill Evans classic with lyric by Jean Lees, and it's from the album Heart's Desire, recorded and produced by my guest today, Janiece Jaffe on vocals, accompanied by Simon Rowe on piano, John Huber on bass, and Pete Wilhoit on the drums. We had to check into the lyric writing here a little bit and find Jean Lees because I mentioned earlier, Waltz for Debbie is usually known as an instrumental. Dynamics between music writers and lyricists are interesting. Often we don't realize that a lot of the lyrics are written after the music. Of course, sometimes it goes the other way around, or ideally, if you're Cole Porter, you just do them together. But most of the time, it's music and the lyricist brings the words to it and interprets to music, thinking, you know, what this could be. And you mentioned that earlier too in your process of writing lyrics for Marcus's song. So you had the music and brought the lyrics to it. As a vocalist though, you are interpreting the lyrics, and I'm just curious to hear a little bit from your perspective when you take a song like this or one like the next one that's a Gershwin and Gershwin song, how you approach the lyrics and the interpretation of it.
I try to put myself in a place in the middle of the song where the song is like wrapped around me. You know, it comes out moment after moment. So I like to be in that moment. I never sing the same way twice. That's just really not the spirit of improvisation. And I think it comes from that place of feeling the song in the moment and feeling what it means to you in that moment. In the next moment, it may not feel the same way. I know that lots of pictures, you know, sometimes songs can bring lots of visuals to me. I sometimes will go off of that, but mostly it's the feeling that the words bring out, you know, from my heart. I want to say it one way. I want to see it, say it another. I think when I first started learning songs, I wouldn't sing a song unless I had sung it already 100 times. So I would never bring it into public without really, really singing it many, many times, turning the words inside out. What is the meaning of this? Double meanings and triple meanings and levels of meanings, and how do I want to do this? And, you know, I mean, there's songs like Say Mean to Me. I saw Bernadette Peters once sing that song, and at the very end, the tear just rolled down her cheek, and I was like, stunning. And she was very still the whole rest of the time. But you could sing that tongue in cheek, you could sing that angrily, you could sing that, you know, from different viewpoints. Points, you know, and in jazz, the words are there. You know, you want to make sure that the writer, the melody gets its day because that's the way it was written. But after that, it's like, ooh, let's take this somewhere else.
Jazz musicians take those songs that were written for musical theater, like a lot of the Gershwin songs, and they just took them as repertoire to do things with and to get creative with and to do that process. You know, it makes absolutely sense to take that and put it into the creative process. So we're going to listen to another one from the Heart's Desire CD. How long has this been going on? It's a Gershwin and Gershwin composition. Yeah. Great example of this great American songbook gets assimilated as a repertoire because the songs are just well crafted. There's meaning to it and they're a great stepping point.
So this was the second cut, and I went ahead and put it on because in the beginning it really kind of shows. We left in a little tag on the front because we were having so much fun and we were laughing, and I was like, let's take another take, you know. So we were laughing. You can hear that in the beginning. I had invited my hairdresser, who I became really close to. Her name was Lark, and she was going through cancer treatment. I invited her to the studio, and she was so excited, but I believe that this was the last time that she could ever drive her truck. So the very last time that she drove her truck, she drove to the studio, and I did not see her. So she came in while we were recording this, or maybe at the beginning, but I think I wasn't facing that way, or my eyes were closed. I'm not sure. But anyway, we had a lot of fun with the song. Then I opened my eyes and I said, "Oh, hi, Lark, honey." And she was like, "I'm going to be famous." You know, there she was with her bandana, you know, around her head, and she was just beaming. And I will just, you know, never forget her in that moment. This is why I chose this cut.
Yeah, let's have a listen to it. I'm not going to spoil it. So here is how long has this been going on from the release Heart's Desire with Janiece Jaffe on vocals, Simon Rowe on piano, John Huber on bass, and Pete Wilhoyd on the drums.
I have been stunned.
I'm sorry. The unknown comic.
Little while, tell me now, how long has this been going on? There were chills up my spine and some thrills I can't define. Listen, sweet, I repeat, how long has this been going on? Heaven and Peru, I know how Columbus felt finding a different world. Can you hear me once, live me once more? What a dance I was before. What a break, for heaven's sake, how long has this been going on?
Gershwin classic performed by my guest today on vocals, Janiece Jaffe, and just a gorgeous, beautiful rendition. And Janiece, we talked a lot about interpreting songs, but let's talk also a bit about groups and picking your partners and the intimacy of doing duets. Because this next, we actually have two duet tracks that we'll listen to. But this next one was a live performance at a local radio station at WFHB with Tyrone Cooper, who is an Emmy Award-winning composer, incredible guitarist. He also heads up the archives of traditional music here at Indiana University. And, you know, doing duets is... it's kind of daring because it's very exposed, and especially if it's just voice and guitar, there's nothing to hide, there's no backup, and every note is pure. But you did a lot of duets and a lot of them with guitars. What's your attraction here?
I don't know, something about those strings, you know. I don't know. And plus, those were the people who were around me, you know, as well as you. But that's, those were the people I was doing gigs with. And I, when I realized what stellar, brilliant players they were, it's really something. And like just doing a duet with a bass is a whole nother story too. That's even more exposed, but there's something about the way that these people played that was so, I don't know, just inspiring. I mean, you know, because I can do things a cappella, it's all gonna come from my own heart and mind. But when you play off of another person, it's very focused movement back and forth. And what you hear kind of leads you to what you're gonna do. And then what you do, if you have somebody really, really awesome who's listening, they're going to go off of that. And, you know, it becomes this like back and forth kind of figure eight kind of thing, you know, co-creating the music. And, you know, I've never wanted to just be out front. I've always just wanted to be an instrument. I've just always wanted to co-create on that level, and really have had a wonderful time developing my ears over the time, you know. And I don't think you ever stop developing any of that. Let's hope not, ever, ever. But Tyrone, I asked to do this live radio show with me because I'd worked with him enough to know that we didn't even have a set list. I mean, sometimes you go to a job and you go, okay, let's do this. Okay, let's do that. Let's do this, you know. And so I knew he could do anything. And so I was driving to the studio. I was just so, it was such a beautiful Saturday morning. And I got there and he was already there tuning up. And I was like, what do you want to do? And then, you know, these songs just came out. They have to be first take because that's it. They're right flat out there on the radio. So so you have to trust each other enough to get that song in the first take. So that radio show became a CD.
That's really cool. You know, and talking about that joy of interacting, I mean, probably one of the ultimate examples is what Bobby McFerrin and Chick Corea did together for a while, just playing off each other, you know, two ultimate improvisers, two master improvisers that just throw these little cues and play with each other. And you actually got to study with Bobby McFerrin quite a bit and see that in action, right?
I did. And I actually got to do a duet with him at one of those times when I went to, actually I've done a couple of duets with him, and oh my gosh, it's so much fun because you just relax because he's got you, you know. He would sing the bass parts, and you know, I did, let's see, I think I might've done Somewhere Over the Rainbow with him. Something like that. And so he just started a bass line and there I was, and it was just so much fun. He's something else to study from and learn from in that arena. I would also like to have a shout out to my mentor, Janet Lawson, because she's the one that wrote the words to this. And she really brought me along quite a ways when I first was starting to sing jazz and had an opera teacher at IU. I went to Janice Borla's vocal jazz camp up in Chicago 3 times in a row. And Janet was one of the teachers there, and I kind of latched on to her. She, please, anybody thinking about it, look her up. She's got some amazing recordings. And so she had put lyric to Blue Bossa.
Janet Lawson, wonderful vocalist who we recently lost. was Grammy nominated for her first album, and yes, please look her up. She also collaborated with Bob DeRoe quite a bit, and many others. Thanks for, crediting the mentors, because it's important that we keep the lineage and pay tribute. So that's very cool. So she wrote the lyrics to Blue Bossa. Blue Bossa is usually another tune performed solely instrumental, one of the great standards. And this is a version that was performed live on the radio, WFHB in Bloomington, with Tyron Cooper on guitar and Janiece Jaffe on vocals. Enjoy.
The flow of water's life beneath the sea draws me ever in life's mysteries. How can I explain the unexplainable? Well, deep within, everything is clear. I touch the water's blue. Song, trusting all unknown, no right, no wrong, waves of rhythms new, feel old, yet strong and true, answering what I always knew.
I touch the water's blue and here.
answering what I always knew. Life's a quest, I surrender to.
Yeah, Tyron here, Tyron Cooper on the guitar.
As performed by my guest today, Janiece Jaffe, live on the radio with guitarist Tyron Cooper and added lyrics by Janet Lawson. And Janiece is my guest today, and we were talking about the intimacy of the duet and the interplay between duet players. And we're going to hear another one of those duets. You did a whole album of duets.
Yeah.
And you handpicked different duet partners. How did you pick the partners?
I'd been working with Marcos Cavalcante for several years already, or maybe it was kind of recently, but we had done a lot of gigs together, you know, weddings and what have you, just as a duo. So that was natural. And then I had gone to a Jamie Abersold camp and met Tom Hildreth, and he was in my group, and I really loved the way he played. And so I asked him, well, why don't you come out and we'll do some duets. And he just, I mean, really all of the ones that we got in the studio, they were first and second takes. There might have been some third takes, but we quit doing third takes because, you know, it was going to be one or the other or nothing. So, yeah. And that was really fun to do that with a bass player, being so exposed on really fun songs like Harlem Nocturne, you know, Angel Eyes, I think was one of them. But yeah, that was very fun. I think we did My Romance. So maybe every other one was voice and bass, and then the other one was going to be voice and guitar. So, and I chose this next one particularly to, not really necessarily because of my vocals, but really because of Marcos's brilliance in his playing. Just blew me away. I don't know how he got those sounds off the guitar to really sound like rain, you know, and really sound like the meaning of the song, but wow.
Yeah, you're right. It's a very picturesque take, and I love it. It's the audio recording is very well done. I love the way your voice sounds on it and brings down those great deep qualities that it has.
Right. Well, thanks to Dave Weber and his studio. I've done pretty much, except for the live album, everything there, a little bit with my son, Chip Reardon, who also has worked there, but Dave Weber, he's got a famous thing going there too.
We have a hidden treasure here in Bloomington. It's on the north end of Bloomington. There's a studio called Airtime Studios. And by now it's actually a retreat. There is places to stay. There is houses. There's a little stage. There were theater productions last summer. It's called The 100th Hill. And the brainchild of Dave Weber's wife, Krista Detour, on bringing the arts community together. And Dave Weber is just an incredible sound designer, and he studied that, and, you know, also notable that Gary Katz, who produced a lot of the Steely Dan recordings, would come to Bloomington, Indiana to produce his recordings because he realized what a treasure we have there. So I'm glad we are pointing this out, because often people think, you know, you have to go produce things in New York and in LA and wherever, but communities have treasures, and this is one of the treasures we have, and
Yes. And do you remember when the studio was upstairs? Because this was literally the second CD that I ever recorded, but it was the first one there. And they didn't have the studio at that time. It wasn't built on. We were upstairs. And so it was very beginnings of that level of brilliance of his ears, you know.
That's true. And I remember we actually did a recording upstairs with a whole band when there was no staircase yet. We were just set up around a big hole in the middle.
yes. Yeah.
But still, you know, brilliance of sound. And so you rewrote the lyrics to this one also. This is a Jobim classic, Rain on the Roses. He did it on the Ella in the Regina, Ella Regina and Tom Jobim duets. So we know it from there. Chovendo na Rosera. I'm trying to not butcher it.
Yeah, that's got to be one of my all-time favorite CDs or recordings ever on the planet. Oh my goodness. Yeah. So I cut a groove in that record for sure. But
rewrote the lyrics.
Yes. I rewrote them in English. And the way that I do that is I really try to stay so close to the meaning of the words in the original language. And so what I did was had Marcos translate them for me, and I would look up translations. And so I just wanted to keep the spirit of the song, but only with English words that would also, the vowel sounds and the consonants really kind of slip out of the mouth easily, you know, so.
Gotcha. Yeah. They do. Let's have a listen. This is so gorgeous. Rain on the Roses from the It Takes Two album. That's a 1997 release by my guest today, Janiece Jaffe on vocals with Marcos Cavalcanti on the guitar. Enjoy.
On the fresh red roses that bob and offer me their fragrance. It fills the air, it fills my mind, it fills my heart, it's everywhere. Carried by the wind, the petals float by her singing. The petals red are winging. Oh, look, the pleasant rain that feeds my roses is soaking earth and filling rivers. It cleans the sky that brings the blue. Falls on everything as equals. It surely belongs to no one. It's of the land, it's of the sea, it's of the sky. It's to be free. All the gods. falls on everything as equals. It surely belongs to no one.
As performed by my guest today, Janiece Jaffe on vocals, with Marcos Cavalcanti on guitar. So we had several duets, and we're going to close the whole circle by going back to another track from the first recording we were listening to from Standing on the Edge, which was also done with Marcos Cavalcanti, but with full band. And another one where you wrote the lyrics to them. I actually remember Marcus telling the story. He wrote the song when he performed for the Atlanta Olympics. He had a chance to perform there. And that's when he wrote the music to it. So, you know, it was with this spirit of seeing a really grand event and witnessing that at the time. And he came back. And so you wrote the lyrics with hope and even brought children to the studio to sing it. So tell us a little bit about that song and how it came together.
Yeah. Well, that one, he didn't give me a whole lot of background on it either. I mean, I know Breakfast in Atlanta was definitely a direct connection with him going there and staying with a friend. And this one, it rocks out in a way that really felt like one of the songs that you could do to get people singing about how to get into the future and change, you know, change any negative circumstance and keep moving and having hope and we have help, and as long as we stay positive, you know, that it'll be that way. And I invited a gaggle of children and a couple of friends who were singer friends of mine to come and sing it with me. And I remember somebody saying, oh, you are crazy for bringing children into the studio. I'm like, no, they have to be there. We need to hear their voices on this song in particular, because they, you know, they are the future, and I want them to have this experience of this, you know, indelible ink of I'll never forget going into the studio and being able to be on a recording, you know. So that was my thinking.
Anyway. Oh, very special experience. I mean, you also do a lot of sound healing and toning with bowls. It's something that probably not everybody is familiar with. Can you tell us a little bit how that works and what kind of effects you can have?
Yeah, sound, actually there's a lot of people saying that sound is kind of the future of medicine. Hmm. That we're gonna be moving away from chemicals and more into particles and waves and energy and sound. And, you know, sound waves, well, you know that when you put on certain favorite music, it will change your mood. And, you know, that's why we have, you know, our teenagers tend to want to listen to more angry songs in some ways, you know, just to get that, you know, get those emotions out. You know, there's purpose for every kind of song. But when you have the intention behind the sound, it changes the quirks of the sound. It changes the whole dynamic of how that sound can be received. And so I find that if I, you know, the more I'm in alignment with my own heart, and the more my intention is for healing and for lifting vibrations in a room, for a person, for people, that the effect of the song or the tones or whatever it is permeates at another level than if I were just to randomly go around toning things, you know, or whatever. So I, you know, I did get into becoming a Reiki practitioner and teacher at the end of the 90s. So for 3 years I studied that. And then I started hearing the energy. So then it got me interested in sound healing. I went on a whole journey with that. And then kind of now it's kind of like, okay, this improvisation and this intuition and this energy work are kind of all wrapped around in a beautiful tapestry that just keeps, you know, expanding and growing. So yeah, that's, I don't know if that completely explains things, but it's...
No, I mean, that's really interesting and obviously a very new field and a very important field for how we can heal things on a level that doesn't need taking in tons of drugs or anything, but that activates, you know, the energies that we have without interfering, you know, with other things and side effects and...
Yeah. And you know, there's more and more Reiki and this level of healing being brought into hospice, being brought into hospitals, being brought into you know, the realm of people healing. And I think more and more physicians are getting hip to the Reiki thing, and it's coming along. And you know, I would never suggest to not go to a doctor. That's not my suggestion at all. But what, you know, the supportive healing, because, you know, that kind of thing has got to be on all levels, not just surgery, not just physical, not just, you know, there's psychological, there's, you know, your intelligence, your emotions, your physical, your energy, you know, all these levels of healing that need to be addressed.
Yeah, thank you for bringing that up and sharing. We need a lot of healing in the coming months. We need a lot of new outlooks and ways to address all of ours, you know, not just the head, but there's more to our body.
Right. And to project ourselves 10 years down the road, and what do we want to see, you know, how do we want to be in the world at that point, you know. So yeah, this hope is a hope call. It's called hope, but really hope call is the essence of it. People, there's a hope call now, and it's resounding and it's sounding, you know. So the words really do call out to, you know, people's hearts to stand up and make their next move of as who they are and what they want to create in the world. Hmm.
I think that's such a beautiful ending. We shouldn't add anything to that except putting out this hope call for move forward, find the purpose, create something new. Nobody go backward, we're going forward.
From now on, and that's live improvisationally.
Live improvisationally. That's the theme of my TED talk coming up too, exactly.
Oh gosh, let's have another discussion on that.
we will. All right, thank you, Janiece, for being my guest today and sharing so many insights in your process and sharing your beautiful, beautiful music.
Thank you, my dear friend, Monika, thank you.
Let's listen to Hope Call. A song written by Marcus Cavalcanti with lyrics by Janiece Jaffe from the 2005 Standing on the Edge release, with Janiece Jaffe on vocals, Marcus Cavalcanti on guitar, Jamie Reed on the drums, Tom Clark on sax, Mark Buscelli on trumpet, John Huber on the bass. Thank you, Janiece. Let's move on forward with
is to let yours be heard. Oh, join the whole.
Talking Jazz. My guest today was Janiece Jaffe, jazz vocalist, sound healer, lyricist, and so much more.
Tune in for Talking Jazz every Thursday at 11 a.m. and every Monday at 7 p.m. right here on WETF 105.7 FM in South Bend, Indiana, or online at WETFthejazzstation.org. Also find videos of previous shows on YouTube on the Monika Herzig channel. That's MonikaHerzig. Subscribe to get the newest updates. Thank you for listening.